So this is going to be either an epic video or an epic fail video. I've wanted to do this for a long time now. I'm actually going to be using a brew bag with a Blickman boil coil, and I hope I don't burn the bag. How's it going? My name is Brian. Welcome to another video. If this is your first time here and you'd like to learn more about electric brewing, see how-to videos and brewing experiment videos just like this one, consider subscribing, and if you do, don't forget to click that bell so you won't miss a video when it comes out. So let me tell you what I've got here as far as the system goes. So I've got a Blickman G2 boiler maker, and it is a 20-gallon. I've got all the standard equipment on that. I've got the boil coil mounted. I've got the standard Blickman valve on there. I do have a whirlpool over here, and that is one of the things that I've kind of wanting to experiment with, is can I recirculate as well? I know a lot of people think that with brew in a bag you don't really have to recirculate, but I want to, so I'm gonna do that. And you know, I've read some stuff online on forums and whatnot. Heat your water up, put your bag in, put your grain in, let it do its thing, don't turn the coils on, but that's no fun, you know. I mean, come on, right? So we're gonna attempt that today. I've also got a Blickman Riptide pump down here. Just got some cam lock fittings and whatnot. And then the power of the system is the Blickman Brew Commander. And so I've got that actually hooked into, it's about the 7-gallon mark in the original brewmometer hole where that would go. And I've got the probe hooked up there. So that's what's gonna be controlling our temperature. And so that's pretty much it. Now, as far as what I'm brewing today, I'm gonna be brewing just a basic brown lager. Got a brother-in-law's birthday party coming up that I wanted to maybe do a beer for. So I'm gonna try to kind of push this one. It's gonna be a pressure lager. You know, I ferment under pressure. Link in the description below for these shirts, by the way. As well as everything else that I'm using here will be linked down below, the bag, the kettle, the controller, all that stuff. So I actually used the Blickman grain mill. So I know a lot of you have been asking me about the efficiency on that. So I'm going to be sharing with you what I experienced in this particular situation. Let me go over what the recipe is really quick. So the batch I'm doing is 11 gallons or 41.6 liters. In that mash, I've actually got 20 pounds of Pilsner malt or 9 kilograms. And then I've got 6 ounces or 170 grams of Carafa 3. As far as the strike temperature goes, the strike water temperature is gonna be 153.7 or 67.6 Celsius. And our mash temperature is gonna be 148 degrees or 64.4 Celsius. I'm using reverse osmosis water. And so I've got all the water in here, 14 gallons. And I've already put my brewing salts in. It was very minimal because I'm using reverse osmosis water, and I use kind of the American Light Lager profile in Brewfather. And so I've got all that in there. I did have to put quite a bit of lactic acid in there to bring the pH down because of the fact that there's not a lot of acid in the malts, and then there's a lot of buffering that goes on from the amount of water that's in there. So I had to put like 10 milliliters of lactic acid in there. So what I'm gonna do now, I'm just gonna go ahead and shut this off, shut the pump off, turn the element off, and I'm gonna go ahead and mash in. Oh, one other thing, a quick disclosure on this, the Brew in a Bag company did send me the bag and some of the other things we're gonna be using. We'll go ahead and put the bag in, and this bag is made specifically for this size of kettle. Go ahead and get some of the grain in here. Okay, pour some more grain in. I did actually use the Blickman grain mill, as I said earlier. One of the things that I did do in the crush, as far as the fineness of the crush, I went a little finer than normal. I went a little bit less of a gap than what the optimal crush setting is on the Blickman mill. And I kind of figured that with doing a brew in a bag, I'm not too worried about a stuck mash or, you know, too much flour getting in the beer, final beer, anything like that. I mean, always going to be a little bit cloudy because of the fact that you're not really doing a big Vorloff or anything like that with brew in a bag, but I think this bag is fine enough that it'll keep most of those fine particles out of there. So put the rest of our grain in, and typically I would go ahead and let this rest for about probably 10 minutes or so before I turn on the recirculation, but I don't want the temperature to drop that much because we're actually at 148.6 right now. So I'm actually gonna set the temperature to 148, our mash temperature here on the Blickman controller. And we're at like 148.3 right now. So that's pretty good. I don't wanna have the element kick on too much because usually when you're doing a mash with electric brewing like this, you're gonna have the mash, the temperature controller, and the element just barely clicks on every so often. If you've seen any of the other videos or used an electric brewing system, you know what I'm talking about. It doesn't stay on for very long. So I'm actually gonna call that good. I'm gonna pull the slack out of here as much as I think we need to. So my hose is actually back over here, and so I'm gonna pull all the slack out of there. And then I'm gonna close this down pretty much. I'm gonna be recirculating through the Whirlpool port. And I've got a hose on the Whirlpool port. I've got it tilted up so that as it recirculates, it's kind of recirculating from the top and then hopefully kind of recirculating through the grain. I don't know how well that's gonna work, but we'll find out. So I'm gonna go ahead and kick on the pump and we'll kick on the element on auto. And we'll start to circulate here. We'll see. Now it's going to circulate outside the bag, and hopefully that'll help maintain the temperature. Where the temperature probe is about right in the middle of where the mash is. So I'm hoping that that will actually work pretty well. Now the temperature controller, it's just barely pulsing, just a little bit. So it doesn't stay on for very long, and that's kind of why I'm thinking that I'm kind of thinking this will be successful because of that. Now I'm not gonna do any kind of a raise for mash out or anything like that because I don't wanna have the element on for a long time. So I'm gonna leave it about there. I got a pretty good little flow around there, and I'm thinking it'll probably, I don't know how much of a whirlpool it'll do, but we've got the outlet of the Whirlpool back here. We've got the outlet from the kettle here, so it's definitely having to go across the kettle. So we'll just leave this on, and we'll put a timer on for 60 minutes, and we'll hit play. There we go. All right, so we're at 148 is what we're set at, and we're at 147.1 right now. So the element is pulsing just a little bit. So we'll come back here in a few minutes and we'll take a pH reading and see where we are with it. And we'll let you know how that's going. All right, be back in a few. All right, so it's been a little bit more than 10 minutes just because I was calibrating my Apera pH meter. I think you can see that on there. We are at 5.3. So that is, well, exactly dropped down to 5.2. So might be a little bit heavy on my lactic acid. No, it's 5.3. So that is exactly what I was targeting. So it's somewhere between 5.2 and 5.3, which is absolutely perfect. And I'm gonna stir it about every 15 minutes or so. I just stirred it before I took the pH sample just to make sure everything was nice and stirred up. So I'll come back here in just a little bit and I will stir it again and we'll show you what it looks like whenever we stir it. All right, we are halfway through the mash and everything has been going good so far. I told you I'd come back, we'd give it a stir. So I'm gonna go ahead and give it a stir here so you can kind of see. The color is a nice, like amber kind of brown, which is what I was really going for. Smells really good. Hopefully you can see that on the camera there. But 150 is right in between these two marks right here. And we are, looks like right at 148. So provided this thermometer is good, we are sitting right where we want to be at. So got our stir done. Go ahead and I will come back whenever I hook up my winch to this eyelet that I've got here in the ceiling and we pull the bag out and see whether or not the bag is still intact. So this should be interesting. Yeah. All right, now the only thing I gotta worry about is the temperature probe up front here and we'll see what happens here. And holy smokes. We have a bag that is completely intact. I'll have to come back after I get all the grain out of it and everything and see if there's any scorch marks. But at this point, I don't see anything on it that looks scorched. Oh, one other thing, too. I meant to tell you this earlier, but this is a little foreshadowing, this video, because Blickman, from what I understand, I don't have any of the details on it yet, other than I know it's coming. There is a basket of sorts that Blickman is working on. Now, I don't know. I don't have any details on what it's going to look like. I don't have any details on how it's going to work, what is, whether it's a slotted bottom basket or if it's just something to hold the bag up off of the coil or what. I don't know. But I will say that this video, I didn't plan it for that particular thing happening. But as it happened, when I told them what I was going to do, they're like, oh, hey, we have a basket coming out for that. So I'm like, oh, well, that's nice. Good to know. So, think about, gotta hold it out here. I tell you what, it's pretty, there's a little bit still coming out. So, and we are 13 and a half gallons. I think my Brewfather calculator said 13.59 gallons, I think, was the pre-boil volume. All right, let me get this all done up, and then I'll be back here in just a second. Can't get these gloves off now. They're too slippery. Okay, I was wrong. The actual boil volume was supposed to be 12 and a half gallons, and I wound up with 13 and a half gallons. I don't know what that is in liters. I'll put it on the screen here. And the pre-boil gravity was supposed to be 1045. I actually wound up with 1048 as the 1048, 1049. I'm gonna say 1048 to kind of err on the side of caution. And according to Brewfather, when I put all the numbers in, we are looking at a mash efficiency of 80.64. So I don't know what the brew house efficiency will be yet, but I got an 80.64% mash efficiency out of this. So I am completely happy. I'm gonna overshoot my mark a little bit. As far as the hops go, I'm gonna be doing 2 ounces or 56 grams of crystal in the boil, and that's gonna be the only addition. Shooting for about 20 IBUs, something that's a nice, easy drinker. So I've got it set to boil now. The coil's at 100%. I'm just waiting on it to come up to boil, then I'll add my hops. But so far, so good. I didn't empty the bag yet, but we'll do a little closer examination of that. And for those of you that have been kind of wondering about that, we've answered the question. I had the element on the entire time it was recirculating. I was recirculating at probably about 60% on the pump through the Whirlpool port. Had no issue scorching the bag. So, woohoo! I was really dreading pulling it up out of there and having grain go everywhere and having to deal with that mess. This might just be a little eye-opening experience or information for some of you out there. So I'll be back here in just a little bit. All right, so I got the bag rinsed off and everything. I want to take a look at it with you guys to see what we see here. I got it emptied out, rinsed off. I don't see, let me flip it up so we can see. There's the bottom of the bag. Anything that would have been resting against the boil coil would be somewhere in this neighborhood right here. This almost looks like maybe, I don't know, it's hard to say for sure. There's like a little bit of a wrinkle right there. Let me see if there's any other ones like that. That could be just the way the bag is made. I don't see any other ones really. I'll be honest with you. Waiting on this to come up to boil so I can add my hops, but I'm stoked so far. All right, so we've reached boil and I'm gonna go ahead and add my 2 ounces or 56 grams of crystal hops into the boil and get those stirred in really nice. I'm gonna be pressure fermenting in the Blickman G4 conical fermenter. I know a lot of you have been waiting for my first ferment in that device, so I'm going to be doing that as well. Look for that to be coming up pretty soon. I'm going to be using Lalemann Diamond Lager yeast, which in the past I've used for lagers, and it's really, really good. I will let this boil, and I'll come back when I'm done and let you know what the results are after the boil and my final thoughts and everything on this method, because I tell you what, I really have liked it so far, but I'll come back with my final thoughts at the end here once we get everything into fermenter and all that stuff. So see you soon. Ended up with just under 12 gallons in the kettle and probably about 11 and a half in the fermenter. I left a little bit behind. When the batch was over, I dropped in the jaded Skilla or Skilla Shilla, whatever, Skilla chiller, got it down to about 75 degrees, shut off the cooling, pulled the chiller out, and it continued to drop down to about 72. Transferred it over to the Blickman G4 fermenter and pitched my Lalamon Diamond Yeast 2-packs, no rehydration, no starter, no nothing. I preset my spunding valve, the Blickman's tri-clamp spunding valve that comes with the G4 or that's available for the G4, set it to about 13-14 PSI. So I will let that just build its own pressure. I get asked that quite often, you know, do I put pressure in it from the start? Do I let it build its own pressure? Generally, I let it build its own pressure. I kind of think, and I don't have any scientific research to back this up, but I think that it's less stressful on the yeast to just start the fermentation and then build its own pressure and then deal with the pressure as it goes. So let me know what you think of the experiment. Is this something that you might want to try doing? One of the recommendations I would say is probably would not ramp up to mash out. I'm afraid that ramping up would probably leave the element on too long and it might actually scorch the bag. I don't know for sure, but I just kind of surmise that. But I didn't have any issues with efficiency or anything like that, so I'm happy with how that turned out. But this has been Brian for Short Circuit of Brewers. We'll see you in the next video.